And joining me now is renowned astrophysicist Neil deGrasse Tyson. He's also the author of the book Cosmic Queries, StarTalk's Guide to who we are, how we got here, and where we're going. Neil, so great to have you here. And we know you're not reporting to us from outer space, although we love the backdrop. Thank you for lighting things up here on a Saturday afternoon. But if tomorrow's flight goes off without a hitch, does this matter to humanity's understanding of the universe beyond just fun for those who can afford commercial space travel? Is that what we're looking at next? Is people are going to fly up to the edge of space for fun and burn a lot of cash?
Well, there's no intended science mission for this, but there's a lot of engineering that is being put on display. All right, a rocket plane, a plane that is deployed from another plane, so it's not from a launch pad, as we saw from the videos, and then that goes to high altitude and then comes back and lands like a regular plane. So it spends a small amount of time in what we say suborbital, where it's not achieving orbital speeds, which is a very different thing for your rocket to do than to just go suborbital. I will say that NASA went suborbital 60 years ago with Alan Shepard. So this is not a new thing for humans to do. If you want to sort of put it in perspective, it's new because like private people are doing it, a couple of billionaires. And so that's kind of new and interesting and novel. But the idea that you're going to send someone suborbital, we've done that before. I'd rather ultimately they got together and said, let's send somebody to Mars, go somewhere, put a destination on the docket.
Right. Maybe have Branson walk on the moon. Maybe he could try that next. We know Branson has never shied away from risks and stunts. Here he is driving an amphibious car across the English Channel while wearing a tuxedo. He's looking very dapper there. Rappelling from a building while drinking champagne. He also launched a Virgin Cola by driving a tank through Times Square. Our staff really went through the archives for this. Branson launches tomorrow morning, Jeff Bezos 9 days from now. Is this all about an ego boost or a rocket boost? What's going on here?
It could be both. You know, billionaires have big egos. Why wouldn't they? And it's their money, you know, so... And it, like I said, it is at least advancing an engineering frontier. Those are some funky looking plane designs, and that's always interesting to watch that unfold and how the design might change once they learn about what this involves. And we all know that there's surely a future in space tourism. There's no doubt about it. You look at the waiting list that exists for those seats right now, and you make the seats a little cheaper, the list grows. It's a highly elastic demand ready to feed that. So I think what's historic is that we're seeing the beginning of an entire industry. And yeah. I'm delighted for them. I'm delighted for the engineers and for the future of that economy. And I'll add that they're launching from New Mexico, spaceport, okay? That word feels a little weird, but is it any weirder than the first people who heard the word airport, okay? Just think about that. Spaceport, airport. So it could be as routine as what time does the train leave or what time does the plane leave? What time does your rocket leave in the future?
It's a step forward. And Neil, of course, we think you would be a fun person to go to space with. You're not in space right now. I kind of feel like my backdrop should have outer space behind me. I don't know if the staff can do this before the segment is over, but I think that would make things even cooler. But anyway.
To be clear, we are on Earth, and Earth is in space. So
that is
in
true.
A way, we are all in space.
That's a very good point. I stand corrected. But if Branson or Bezos asked you to go along on a future trip, what would you say?
Well, I've joked about this. So I've joked about it with Elon, because Elon wants to send you to Mars, Neil. Will you say yes? And I'll say, I'm going to wait until he sends his mother and brings her back safely, then I'll go. And so right now, with Jeff Bezos and Richard Branson putting literal skin in the game, that is the greatest demonstration they can offer for the safety and efficacy of what it is they're putting out there. So now, between you and me, they didn't need to do this because they already had a waiting list for those seats. Did he really need to do this to show how safe it was? I think he really just wanted to fly on his plane, on his rocket plane.
Yeah. And you mentioned Mars. What is the realistic timeline to get someone to Mars? And if so, would there be a way to bring them back that we know of? Or is it a one-way ticket for the person to go there? I mean, I feel like this is where all of these steps are leading us, right? We're trying to get back to the moon. We're trying to take commercial space flight to the next level. What about Mars?
Well, it's not leading there. If you're perfectly happy to say, we have a new kind of space tourism and you go into low Earth orbit or even Earth orbit and then you come back out. All right, that you can get that done in a few hours. So, you know, or stay in orbit, you know, 10 times, that's a day. Mars is years. You don't have that, unless you're really wealthy, you don't have that much time for a vacation, all right, and still expect to keep your job when you return. So they're not the same thing. It's just a different kind of marketplace that is being tested right now. In terms of the future, will we put people on Mars? I'm a contrarian in that, with that question. I'm thinking we'll never put anybody on Mars unless there's very strong motive to do that, either economic or for security reasons, just to do it because it's the next step after the moon. I don't see that happening. We didn't go to the moon because it was there or because it was in our DNA. We went to the moon because we were scared witless. Can I say witless? Yes, I can. We're scared witless because of the Soviet Union. Who has the new high ground? And they beat us in practically every space metric that there was. The first satellite, the first human, the first woman, the first dark-skinned person, the first space station. They had all the first, but we got to the moon first and we said, okay, we win. Fine, but that's what motivated us. Let's not sort of dust that under the rug and pretend we only do this because we're explorers.
Right. And before we go, I have to ask you about this, Neil. I know you've been asked about it, but we need you to chime in on this. This government report released last month on UFOs, largely inconclusive. Was there anything in there that moved the needle for you? I mean, we have folks who work at CNN who desperately want this to be the UFOs, to be, you know, alien spacecraft and so on. I mean, it would be phenomenal if that were the case, but we just did not get any kind of conclusive proof in that report. What did you make of that whole thing?
Well, Hollywood has spent many a decade priming us to want there to be aliens, or at least peaceful aliens, all right? Right. It's in our culture, it's in our mindset. And so, I've resisted that, I think, successfully. When I see fuzzy things in a monochromatic Navy video, I say, I don't know what that is. And I'm kind of okay just simply saying, I don't know what that is. And of course, that's what the U stands for in UAP, Unidentified Aerial Phenomena. By the way, who's the government fooling? That's just different letters to say UFO. So I don't know why they did that. They really mean UFO. So
our tax dollars at work.
They're not fooling anybody. That's certainly not me. But anyhow, just because you don't know what it is doesn't mean you then know what it is. So I'm perfectly content to say maybe it's a glitch in the software or the hardware. And there are people who will say, we've checked the software and hardware, and it can't be that. Excuse me, every time you acquire an update on software, it's because there was a bug somebody had just found in it. And that happens continually, especially the more complex the instrumentation is. So if I'm a betting person, I would say maybe it's the software or the hardware. Or maybe it really is aliens. I just need better evidence than that. And 3 billion smartphones are now in this world. We have crowdsourced any possible alien visitation that could arrive on this planet.
We're gonna find out.
Everybody's got video camera and a still camera taking high resolution color. You could stream that. It would be viral instantly. Cat videos go viral doing much less than that. So I'm not as convinced that if aliens are coming, they're only going to reveal themselves to Air Force or Navy pilots.